He's forsaken a comfortable life to live out of a backpack.
I went there feeling so insecure. I empty my bank account later and just go for it.
Discover what it means to be an unusual soldier on today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Well, welcome to the show. The motto of the U.S. Coast Guard is "So others can live." For today's guest, that motto drives his own work. Caleb Bislow is an unusual soldier. He's traveled the world, from African villages to South American prisons. It's a scary job, but Caleb puts his fear aside for one reason: to ensure that others may live.
I went into ministry shortly after college, but it didn't take long for me to realize that the ministry God was calling me to would be far from typical. I wanted to live my life for Christ like an unusual soldier, on a mission to bring hope to those that are often feared by the church, places of risk, places that I like to refer to as the 13th floor. But my inadequacy haunted me. The more I meditated, the more afraid I became. What could I do? I didn't know enough. I was just an art major in college. It would cost me all the money that I had. It would be hard on my family. And what if I failed? God began to deepen my conviction, especially when I would look at a world map. I became grieved, knowing that two-thirds of the world was still unreached. Late one night, I decided to push the button. I've discovered that God can use ordinary people to have an impact in places of risk, but there are still millions of people in dark, dangerous, and despised places who are waiting for someone to bring them hope. So buckle up, because you might be the next person God calls to push the button. This is my dangerous invitation.
Well, please welcome the author of Dangerous, Caleb. It's great to have you here.
It's great to be with you.
How did you get the call? You talk about the call that you knew that God has something very unusual for you.
I became a youth pastor after college, but about 5 years in, I knew that God was putting a new calling on my heart. I pick up hitchhikers as a youth pastor with youth kids, and that didn't go well with the parents. And so I began to research the world, and I said, God, what are you calling me to? And as I studied the world, there was a tribe in Africa that I would read about, and I began to tear up, and I didn't know what God was doing. And that was the beginning, really, of a calling God was putting on my heart.
Was that the Maasai?
That was the Maasai tribe, yep, in Africa.
What drew you to them?
I think it was just trying to hear God's voice, but I did read that they were a warrior tribe, and they would hunt lions, and I don't know, maybe that identified with my adventurous spirit a little bit also, but I know that I read about unreached Maasai, and that really grieved me, and that's what really allowed me to empty my bank account later and just go for it and see what God had in store there.
Well, what would you tell somebody that has that leaning? They want to do this, but why is it so important, that first step, to say, okay, I'm all in? What would you tell them to do?
Well, I would say, number one, don't count yourself out. I think if you read through the Bible, God has a history of using ordinary people. Mm-hmm. Some people may watch the interview today and say, well, Caleb, he's a little extreme. He used to race dirt bikes. But God looks for the humble person. And number one, don't count yourself out, because I went there feeling so insecure. And, you know, after I've gone,
he also uses the rejects.
Yeah, he uses the rejects, which I feel like a lot of times
King
as well.
King David was rejected. His brothers rejected him. His father said to Samuel, "Are you sure? This isn't the right one." And he likes doing that.
Yeah, and I tapped into other spirit-led followers of Christ, and I got confirmation, mm-hmm. and I got a little training, and I think that that's all important.
How important was the training for you?
The training is extremely important, but, you know, for that first trip, I was just a youth pastor, a graphic design major at that point, and I felt inadequate, felt like I didn't have enough. Mm-hmm. But when I did go, we saw entire villages come to Christ, and since then I've seen multiple churches started, and I didn't realize it just through the power of the Holy Spirit, God could allow that to happen through me. So he kind of trained me through some of the Maasai Christian men there on the fly a little bit. So training, I believe, is extremely important. But also, I think the Holy Spirit is our main guy.
Yeah, I would say he's more important.
Yeah, I think so, too.
You can have a lot of training, but if you don't have him, mm-hmm. you're not going to get results. What was the first breakthrough for you? You write about it in the book.
One of them was there with the Maasai tribe. There was one village that had beaten Christians in the past. And my mm-hmm. translator, Simon, says, "We need to go to these places, too." And I was really scared.
You didn't want to be beaten.
No, leaving last words on my video camera to my wife. And I said, "Simon, should we really go to these places?" And he said, "There's no greater place there's no greater way to die than for Jesus." And I love that attitude. And we went there and saw the same men had beaten Christians respond mm-hmm. to Christ and started church there. And that was just a huge breakthrough for me. And since then, I've never called any place unreachable.
What triggered that? Because they had beaten men who'd come to them mm-hmm. to witness before. What was different this time?
That's a great question. I think maybe it was our compassion. You know, I loved these people. I didn't just come in with a pre-planned sermon and we blow up and leave, but I just loved them. And I think Simon did too. And I think that they saw that love in our eyes.
Mm-hmm. Love never fails.
It doesn't.
Nope. If it's not working, it's not love. And if love's there, it's going to work.
That's right.
Where else have you gone? You've gone to the prisons of South America.
Yeah, I've gone to a lot of continents, a lot of places. The prison was one place where there was a lot of beheadings, gang rivalry that took place right before we went in. And we got to actually get into the solitary confinement area where people hadn't gone before. And it was just an amazing experience to minister to the hardest of hard in that area. Even the guards told us probably not to do this, but they allowed us in. They didn't come in with us, left us in there, but it was neat to be able to minister to those people there.
So you went to the hardest of the hard, and the guards left, didn't want to be with you. And I assume they closed the door.
Yeah, you're locked in there with them. And if you read a lot, the guards are at times inmates. It's kind of a hierarchy of inmates ran by inmates. It's not mm-hmm. so much that way anymore, but it was a very intimidating place. And I remember looking at my friend with me saying, "This could be it." I mean, this was a scary moment for me to minister to them, but it was well worth it.
What did you do to overcome the fear?
Again, I think it's love. Perfect love cast out fear. And I've noticed that many places in the Congo. I know we've met a girl once who her whole family was massacred. And she said to me, she said, "I have no one." And when I hear people say things like that, I don't care about my fear anymore. I just want to help these people. And I talked to prostitutes on the streets who said, "No one's helping us. We don't want this lifestyle. We want to be ministers of the gospel, but we have no one to help us." And I don't know. The fear goes away. All I can think about is helping those people.
You talk about Congo as being one of the hardest places on the planet right now.
Sure.
And you have a real heart for that country. What started that?
Well, it was just learning about it in the news, and then we ended up going there and just meeting some of these people, the women who have been raped and abandoned by their husbands. It just grieved my heart. And then you know, one of our guys, he went through training with us, and he had a heart for the rebels in the Congo, and he's a massage therapist. And you would think, oh, God would never send a guy like that there, but he's gone there, and he started a church with some of the FDLR men, some of the what people would call rebels there, and he's doing the impossible, and that's what I love about God.
Yeah, a lot of people don't know that the Congo is sort of, I mean, it's warlords. There's in parts of that country, there's no organized government anymore.
Right. And there's multiple rebel groups there, and I know my friend, when he last went there, the city Goma broke out in war right when he was there, but for some reason, he was so alive in that moment to be there and to still go in and minister to those people.
What if someone feels called, but around them, family is saying no, maybe even the church is saying no, what would you tell them?
Look for spirit-led people. I know my first trip to Africa, I love my mom, but she said, Caleb, don't go. Mm. And she's being protective. And now she loves telling the stories to people, you know, how God has shown up and how multiple people have come to Christ and how churches have been started. And, you know, that first time when you go over there, you will get people giving you, I call it grasshopper talk, saying, making you feel small or that you shouldn't do that. But I've noticed that once you talk to spirit-led people, it might be a no. You have to be open to that. It's not always a go. Mm-hmm. But that's what I try to tap into, is people that I know that are in the Scripture and will tell me really what they sense God is saying.
Where's next for you?
Well, it's an undisclosed area, so I can't go into all the details, but we're going to be launching a conference, a disciple launching conference in a closed area, mm-hmm. and we're going to have to meet in different locations underground, and very excited, kind of a new endeavor that we're pursuing.
Well, go with God, go with love, and you'll stay safe.
Thank you.
Caleb, thanks for being with us. You can find out more about his ministry and his Stranded program by going to 700clubinteractive.com, and Caleb's book, Dangerous Living, is available nationwide. Well, up next, a woman puts her life in danger just for a drink of water. Find out how CBN Partners took care of her greatest need after this. Marriage is one of life's greatest gifts, but it's not without its challenges.
Those hard things don't have to be the end. They can be a decision to make a turn for a new, healthy, strong marriage.
Keys to a successful marriage on the next 700 Club Interactive.
In 2008, my husband Gary departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, God, how do I do this? Where do I do this? Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
For Bible-believing Christians, we're able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they begin to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
A lot of it was image. People would come to our house that we had to entertain. So we kind of had a house that we couldn't even afford.
When the bills would come in and they would be past due, I would automatically get upset at Christian. We began to learn more about our finances and about giving, and that's when we decided to give to CBN.
When you become obedient with your finances, there's so many other areas in your life that God opens up for you.
Yeah, we just love you.
We're Christian and Colleen Bunsey, and we give to CBN.
For one young mother, it took hours of walking to reach a source of clean water. She had to make that trek balancing a jar on her head and a child on her hip. But that wasn't the worst part of the journey.
So Mindy and her tribe struggle to survive in the forests of southern India. Even getting water is a dangerous ordeal for this young mother.
It took me several hours. I couldn't leave my child alone for that long, so I carried her with me. As my neighbors and I walked through the forest, we would come across snakes, scorpions, wildcats, and many other animals. It wasn't safe at all, but we had no other choice.
Even after making the difficult trip, there was no guarantee they would find water.
Sometimes we had to dig holes and wait for the water to slowly seep in.
Then the local pastor asked Operation Blessing's Living Waters team for help. They drove deep into the forest with drilling equipment. After striking water, a well was constructed and a hand pump was installed. So Mindy and her village celebrated, knowing they would no longer have to risk their lives just to get drinking water for their families.
The well is right in our village, so I can get water anytime. We are safe and happy. Thank you so much for coming here and helping us.
And thank you. If you're a member of the 700 Club, you're part of blessing her. If you're not a member, join with us. Join in everything we're doing around the world. How much is it to be a member? It's just $20 a month, 65 cents a day. So go to the phone, call us. It's toll-free, 888-777-1999. And if you want to give a designated gift so that people could have drinking water, we've dug over 10,000 wells and cisterns around the world, but the need is still there. Even with that 10,000, we're looking at 140,000 villages in India that lack clean drinking water, that have the same conditions you just saw. So the need is great. And if you want to designate your gift to clean drinking water, all you have to do is go to cbn.com. There's a place on the giving page where you can designate the gift to the Living Water Program, and your gift will go to help people get fresh drinking water. Well, still ahead, one robbery leads to a crime spree. How one man's conviction gave him the freedom he was longing for. After this.
These boots are made for walking, but not these, or these, and definitely not these.
We tend to do things to our feet, such as squeeze them into pointy-toed shoes or pretty high heels that can make those problems accelerate.
So what's a girl to do when she wants to look fashionable and be comfortable?
Women look far more beautiful when they walk comfortably in a shoe than when they're tottering because it's uncomfortable.
Good news for your feet on the 700 Club next.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
It's just sad. It's sad that in a matter of minutes, people can trash you and your business on the internet and get away with it. Did you know 9 out of 10 customers do an internet search before they buy? So when a former employee unfairly attacked you online, or an unhappy customer put you in a ripoff report, there was nothing you could do about it but watch your customers leave and your reputation suffer. Until now. Reputation.com gives you the power to protect yourself online. The internet can spin your life and job out of control, but Reputation.com watches over you online and improves your reputation by promoting the truth. Reputation.com protects everything you've worked so hard for, doing the things you just can't do yourself. Call now and get a free, detailed analysis of your online presence. Our reputation advisors will show you where the danger is and how much you have to risk.
Call 1-800-791-4911 for your free reputation review. That's 800-791-4911. Call now.
CBN TV on CBN.com. All the video you love in one easy-to-use location.
After a string of armed robberies, Reggie Williams landed on Nashville's most wanted list. But that didn't stop Reggie's crime spree. He continued to use the same MO time and again until he was shot in the act.
When Reggie Williams was a boy, he had to make a choice: follow the Christian faith of his father or his friends on the streets. His decision would set the course for his life.
The streets drew me. They were more attractive, and my peers was more attractive, and you know, the crime was more attractive because that's what they were into. I mean, you see that growing up, so you don't look at it as being wrong, actually. And you go on through life pattern that, you know, it just builds it like a snowball effect. It was like I would befriend you as long as you had what I wanted, and I would use you to get it. And once I got it, it was like we never existed. We never were friends. So.
As he grew older, the crimes got bigger and the stakes got higher. When Reggie's brother was fired from a fast food restaurant, he came to Reggie with an idea.
We set out to rob the McDonald's, and we did. And so once we all counted up the money and we got away with it, he was like, well, you know, I got a big idea. Let's rob them all, you know? So we did. It was the same method every time. You know, take the manager to the safe, put the gun to their head, and threaten them and do whatever you had to do to make sure that they cooperated. Whatever it took to get the money.
He got used to the lifestyle of a big-time criminal, but it came at a cost.
You got cash and you can buy this and that, but you're not thinking about your people you're hurting. You're not thinking about you could get hurt. You're just thinking about one thing, the money and your selfish means and what you want. And when you're at that place, you're in a dangerous place. It's only a matter of time before it all comes to a head and you don't even realize it.
For 3 months, he and his friends eluded police. One night, they robbed a convenience store. A plainclothes officer had been following them, and Reggie's crime spree came to an end.
Had his gun pointed, he was saying something, but I couldn't understand it. And so I'm thinking in my spirit, like, man, look, take cover.
Drop your weapon!
Felt this sharp pain and heard this ringing in my ear. Happened to look back at the window and realize that he had shot me because I could see the bullet hole in there. Tossed my gun. I told my charge partner I'm shot, and so let's, you know, get over it, you know, get out of here.
Reggie was arrested and taken to a hospital. As he talked to a nurse, he realized just how much he had wasted his life.
I know that, you know, this is serious. I have 6 charges of aggravated robbery, and I'm looking at a lot of time. She said, what happened to you? And that ring through my spirit. Like, you know, it's like as if God was talking to me. What happened to you? From what point did you veer off? I had so much potential. I had so much, so many plans for you. What happened? Man, you know, I can't believe I'm at this point.
He was convicted of 14 counts of aggravated robbery and sentenced to 30 years in prison. In those first days, Reggie remembered the faith his father tried to instill and called out to God.
I actually couldn't pray. I was so overwhelmed in my spirit that I couldn't do nothing but cry. But God knew, and God understood, and he heard me. And I felt like, you know, a weight was lifted. That's where I met him, you know. That's where he met me, and we worked on building it back. The whole time I was there, I learned. I soaked up as much as I could, and I used that to get what God showed me that he had in store for me. From that point on, it was like my life was, you know, taking on a different turn.
He devoted himself to reading the Bible and prayer and surrounded himself with people who helped him grow in his new faith.
He said, okay, Reggie, I'm gonna do a new thing in your life. I'm gonna give you new people to look up to, new people to learn from. And everywhere I went, every prison, even out the prison, he always placed somebody in my life to give me a positive influence.
Reggie served more than 10 years in prison. Today, he teaches young people how to avoid making the same choices he made.
Now it's like, instead of taking from my neighbor or from my brother, it's, what can I do to help him? And that gave me so much joy, man, to really just know that, hey, I'm still useful, that you haven't forgotten me, that you haven't given up on me, even when I gave up on myself. Oh, when I realized how much God loved me, that compelled me to love him back. It compelled me to love him back. And I can only show him that I love him by giving. Whether that's on my time or my talent or whatever means that he told me to do it by. When I should have been killed in the streets, he allowed it to happen. You know what I mean? When I should have been alone, he didn't allow that to happen. He showed me mercy, and he had grace on me, even when I didn't deserve it. You know what I mean? And that compels me to do the right thing.
And it will compel you to do the right thing. Don't try to clean yourself up. Let him do it. But he's asking you that same question that he asked Reggie. What happened to you? You had so much promise. You were on the right path. Why did you leave it? Why did you go your way as opposed to God's way? Well, if you're answering that question, I don't know. Well, there's a good news for you. Is that just like Reggie, all you have to do is turn. And then you'll find that same love that Reggie found. So often when we're doing things we know are wrong, we think God doesn't have anything to do with it anymore, that we've gone too far. There's no way a righteous God could ever love us again, that we could ever be right in His sight. Well, that's just the lie of the enemy. That's not true. The Bible says that Jesus Christ came to save sinners. And then it adds, this saying is worthy of all acceptance. That's the purpose that Jesus lived for. You. To redeem you, to save you. And that same love, and that same unmerited grace, there's not one of us that deserves it, that's earned it, but it's that same thing that in turn compels us to love Him back. Well, we understand just how much He loves us, and He doesn't want to be separated from us. He wants us to be with Him for all eternity. Well, then we're compelled to love Him back. Now, His love doesn't fail. And it hasn't failed you, and He hasn't rejected you, and He hasn't left you alone. In Him, we live and move and have our being. So when you want to turn, all you have to do is reach out. And just like Reggie, it's not based on the words you say, it's based on your heart. When you seek me, you will find me. When you seek me with all of your heart. So today, why don't you do that? Well, you already know what you're doing isn't right. You already know that your lifestyle isn't leading you anywhere. Turn. Let Him take over. He'll redeem you. He'll save you. He'll change you from your innermost being. It's all free, and it's all just for the asking. So if this is you, this is what you want. Just bow your head and let's pray a very simple prayer. And let Jesus do for you what He did for Reggie. Let's pray. Jesus. That's right. Just say it out loud. Jesus. I come to you and I need to turn my life around. So Jesus, right now, I just surrender to you. And I ask that you come into my heart, that you make me new, that you put me back on the path that you intended for me. And Jesus, I need forgiveness. I need to know that I've been set free from the things that I've done wrong. Hear my prayer. Answer it today, for I ask it. In Jesus' name. Father, for those who just prayed, I ask for a baptism in your love. I ask that your love would be poured out over every sin and cover it and let them know just how much you love them and have set them free. I ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed with me, the Bible says that if you believe in your heart, and then confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. So I want you to do that. Made it easy for you. All you have to do is go to the phone, make a toll-free call. 888-777-1999. Just say, I prayed with that guy on TV, and I want Jesus in my life. When you call, I've got something for you, and it's free. It's a CD teaching. What do you do now? How do you live the Christian life? What do Christians believe? It's called A New Day, and it's yours for the asking. All you have to do is make a toll-free call. We'll send it right to you. There's no financial obligation at all. We also encourage you to join a local church, go through water baptism, and start reading the Bible every day. Well, that's all the time we have. We'll leave you this word from Colossians. Walk in wisdom toward those who are outside, redeeming the time. Let your speech always be with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer each one.